you're not good enough at ultrasound, that's not an excuse to punish your patients with radiation.
Get out there, ultrasound some hearts, some lungs, some IVCs. Let us know how you feel about it.
He, you know, got his wrist pain by doing over-aggressive high fives to his buddies.
Hello, Ultrasound Podcast listeners. Welcome to the second Ultrasound Podcast, Little Itty Bitty. We're going to talk about ultrasound-guided subclavian lines today. This came up recently at my university when we were looking at our complication rates of central lines. We thought about actually moving subclavian down the list or off the list of preferred sites because we were having some pneumothoraces when placing subclavian lines. Several people brought up the point, though, that, you know, this is a good line. It's a nice, clean line. It's more comfortable for patients. And when our residents get out of training, if they haven't placed a lot of subclavian lines, when they do have to place one, they are going to have higher complication rates then because they don't have the experience. So we thought about, well, will ultrasound make a difference? How can we decrease these pneumothorax rates but still give our residents the training and still be able to use this line? If you'd asked me this question a couple years ago, I'd have told you, no, that's crazy. You got a great landmark there. Just place the line. Don't waste your time with ultrasound here. But I've been burned by the literature before, and I was burned by the literature this time.
So that burned by the literature quote was kind of an inside joke that needs some explaining. During residency, we had a trauma surgeon who wanted to do something, clearly not supported by the evidence. You know, malpractice-y. We knew it was wrong, and someone pointed out to him, I wonder if we could do it this way. It would seem that the more current literature would suggest this is a much better way of getting this done. And his response was classic for this guy. He said, well, I've been burned by the literature before, so I stick with my experience now. And this quote was all at the same time hilarious, sad, and very instructive for me in the youth of my training as to how I didn't want to practice. So there you go. Now you're in on this inside quote joke. Is that a term? Quote joke?
In 2011, in critical care medicine, there was a great study on this. What they did is they randomized over 400 patients to landmark versus ultrasound guidance when placing a subclavian line. Now, I normally like to call the landmark technique the blind techniques. I think that's a more appropriate name, but it is landmark here. I mean, like I said, you've got the nice clavicle, a good landmark. So how much of a difference would ultrasound make for this line? A pretty big difference in their study. This is a big, nice randomized study, and they found that the success rates went from 87.5% to 100% with ultrasound guidance. The pneumothorax rates, which is what we were really worried about, went from 5% down to 0%. Now, are you ever going to get to 0% complication rate for a procedure? Absolutely not. But in their study of over 400 patients, they did get there. So this did seem to be statistically significantly better than the landmark technique when talking about complication rates and every outcome measure that they actually measured. It was better. So this is a pretty convincing study. There have been a few other small studies, but this is the one, the really big, nice one that I think answers the question best for us. So how do you do this? Well, first, you want to find an unsuspecting tech in your emergency department at your practice. And you want to take their sweater off instead of leave it on like I did here. But I'm going to image through the sweater just to show you the technique. So you're going to go to your normal landmarks. You find your clavicle. You find the subclavian vein just underneath it. You got that clavicle shadow. You saw it here. You don't see it anymore. As I'm scanning out laterally, I see the subclavian artery. I'm compressing. The vein is actually not appearing there. But as I slowly scan more immediately, you'll see the vein appear again. There it is. Once you have it in short axis, again, there's the clavicle shadow. You're going to place a line. If you're doing it in short axis, you're going to want to follow your needle tip. This is by far the most important thing. Fan or slide the probe to follow that needle tip. If you don't follow that needle tip and see it the whole time, you may as well not use ultrasound. You may as well do it blindly. If you're not going to see the tip, you're going to get pneumothoraces if you don't watch that tip the whole time. That's very important. I want to stress that because it's a mistake that I see made most often by new users of ultrasound when placing lines. Here's a couple of pictures of long axis subclavian placement. You can see in the bottom left-hand corner the nice long subclavian and the pleural line just behind it. This is a nice picture to show you how close the lung is. This is why we get pneumothoraces when we place subclavian lines, because we've got a needle pretty close to the lung. You can pop it pretty easily. On the bottom right-hand corner, you see a nice picture of the long axis approach. For a vein that's large like this, and you can get the probe, the needle, and the vein, the whole thing lined up really nicely, this can be a nice option going in long instead of short. For peripheral veins, I think the short axis is generally easier, especially for new learners, than the long axis, because it's hard to get all three lined up, and you don't really have a straight peripheral vein all that often that you can use. But for this, a long axis may be a really nice approach. Here you see some more pictures. You see the guide wire in the bottom left-hand corner, and you can actually see the catheter as you thread it in. It's this nice confirmation to see you're in where you think you are. Here's an image showing the lung again highlighted in green. It's so close, so you have to see that needle tip the whole time. Here's a video. You see the needle tip appear right here just above the vein. And as you're slowly fanning and sliding with the placement, remember, you got to see that needle tip the whole time. You'll see it puncture into the vein. So hopefully that was helpful. That's how to place an ultrasound guided subclavian line. Very short. The complications are going to be the same as your normal central line placements as far as infection and things like that. I mean, the things that you need to watch for. The rates of complications aren't the same. I've shown you the literature on that. So thanks for watching. And give us another topic that you want to hear an ultrasound podcast little itty-bitty on.
So a little itty-bitty editor's note. There are actually two separate approaches to the subclavian vein under ultrasound guidance. This is the infraclavicular approach, which was studied in the paper I mentioned. The other approach is the supraclavicular approach. Mike has actually published on this approach, so he's going to tell you more about it in another little itty-bitty shortly. Meanwhile, if you really wish you could just have us show you this technique in person, well, guess what? You can. CastleFest is already starting to fill, so be sure and go to castlefest2013.com and register. Mike Stone and Vicky Noble will be personally offended if you don't. Good enough at ultrasound, that's not an excuse to punish your patients with radiation.
Get out there, ultrasound some hearts, some lungs, some IVCs, let us know how you feel about it.